when you tie people's blood, you fractionate blood. Okay, and this is like the first slide at the beginning of the lecture. But for those of you who haven't watched the YouTube video yet, you have plasma, you have the buffy coat, and you have erythrocytes. You have these different fractions of blood. And for the purposes of our class, our test, when we talk about donating blood, we're not donating whole blood. Usually what happens is you donate the part that provides the oxygen carrying capacity. And which component is that? This, the crypt, the erythrocytes. And you know, you can, there are reasons why you need to give plasma and other things to people. The buffy coat has the thrombocytes. But generally speaking, just so you know what you'll be tested on, when I say you donate blood, this is what you're donating, the packed red blood cells, which would be resuspended in some kind of sterile saline and reinfused into somebody else. Okay, so we'll just fill that out. Yeah, the different fractionate blood. When you go donate blood, they're gonna fractionate it out. They'll save everything. Okay. But again, if you're a donor for our test, what are you donating? Yes. Or you keep that straight in your head, you'll be okay. There's different fractions here. Plasma up top, puffy coat. Puffy coat is white because it has white blood cells in it. Erythrocytes. Remember, urethra means red, and then you have, sometimes you just call it crypt. Okay, so those are the fractions of blood, and what we're concerned with in blood typing, in blood, the antibodies circulate in the plasma compartment. Okay. They got the antibodies. I'll just put ABs for short, okay, in the top component. In the bottom component, you have the red blood cells, and all of your body cells have antigenic molecules on it, including the red blood cells. That's how your immune system can recognize you, by recognizing your self-antigens. But if you put your blood in somebody else, there may be a problem. So that's the point here. So RBCs have the antigens. Here in that component. Okay, obviously your whole blood is circulating, it's all mixed up and it's all circulating as a liquid in your veins. Okay, we're talking about when you donate just that component to somebody else. All right, so here's the problem here. So let me draw another one here. Let's say you have the same fractions. Plasma, buffy coat, erythrocytes. We're just paying attention to plasma and crypt. Okay? This is what you donate. And if you're receiving someone's blood, you worry about the antibodies that are, you know, that recipient has. Okay? So whenever you have a donor-recipient thing, well, that's two people. So you always have to, you know, when you kind of solve these problems, designate someone has to be the donor giving the blood, and someone who needs the blood is the recipient. Okay. There are different reasons why you have to do blood transfusions. Chemotherapy patients, the chemotherapy, man, it zaps everything. Hair follicles, bone marrow. So those patients need to be transfused. Anemia, right? People have maybe severe sickle cell anemia, they need transfusions. So there are different reasons why you need to do transfusions if you're a recipient. Okay. So let's kind of use a simple shape thing. Antibodies have antigens. Here's a red blood cell. And let's say there are different shapes on it. Say, I don't know, I'll put circles, I guess, I don't know. Circles. Let's say the little circles represent antigens. If you have different antigens, it represents different types of blood. I won't even name them now. I'll just name them later, but just to get the concept across. And so it's possible there are antibodies that can interact with those antigens to attack it. And so if you're an antibody that can attack that antigen, so I'll just draw kind of a simple shape that fits that. So I'll draw a green antibody to rest the antigen. So this could attack that. Okay. Let me draw just a couple other shapes that I commonly use. If I draw, I don't know, a triangle, there could be an antibody shape that has that triangle shape fit that. And I'll draw a third one, because there's usually three different antigens that we talk about in the different blood types. Say a square. Right? A person could have an antibody that attacks that antigen. So that's what antibodies do. I know we haven't had the immunity chapter yet, but antibodies are produced by these cells called the B cells, B lymphs. B lymphs could become plasma cells if you have an infection. And plasma cells produce the ABs. And these are just proteins that circulate in the plasma of everybody. Okay, your army of antibodies is the simplest ammunition of your immune system. And they just kind of bind up stuff, and it just helps your body get rid of the non-self pathogen. So it's the plasma cells that produce ABs. My shorthand for antibodies. Okay, so and again, in our fractionated picture of blood here, where do the antibodies, which component are they in?
Top one.
They're in the plasma. So if you're receiving blood, okay, you have red blood cells, but we're not concerned with that. We're concerned with the antibodies you have that could potentially attack this. So for example, if this person has that, is there a problem? If he's the donor and he's the recipient, do you see a problem?
Yes.
You should be saying yes. It's very simple to see. If you don't, you're not seeing it because it's too early, so waking up. Here's the idea. If you give this person that, and they have I'll just draw the cells round. I mean, that'll be attacked. And you'll have agglutination, and it could lead to death. Okay, so that's why we have to, like, type them. Can this person safely receive that? Well, if they have that circulating, no. I mean, let me give you another scenario. So, let me draw another one. Now that's the donor, that's the recipient. Do you see a problem if these people exchange blood? There is not a problem. There is nothing that will cross-react with that. See, that's a square, and I drew circle, triangle, right? So that's the basic idea, right? Now if you understand that, you basically understand everything you need to know. Are there any questions on this?
Okay.
Yeah.
So the first one you drew, wouldn't it go with the circle antibody?
Yeah. It would would be attacked by the circle antibody.
Why is that? Well, isn't that a certain antigen for it? I mean, isn't
yeah.
the right antigen for it?
Yeah. The antibodies are made to attack the antigen that it fits.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Normally, you want it to do that because it's a foreign invader that you want to get rid of. But when you're on, by design, trying to give someone else's blood, you don't want that to happen. All right, well, all right, if you get that, let me just kind of go through these next slides then. So the donor's blood, attacked by recipient's immune system, the antibodies, sometimes they're called agglutinins. Okay, so associate that word with antibodies. Sometimes they call the antigens agglutinogens. So that's another word for that. And I'll kind of put stars next to those words because those words are used in the procedures for your blood typing lab on Monday. And students always, I can never keep them straight in my head, but so antibody is agglutinin, agglutinogen is antigen. Anyways, getting back to this. Donor's blood attacked by recipient's antibodies causes agglutination. That's when you have a cross reaction. Agglutination is a problem. Just kind of read this. It can cause kidney problems, basically they build tiny blood clots. It can lead to death, basically. That's what you're trying to avoid. But here's a picture of agglutination, where you have RBCs, with the antibodies, with the surface antigens on them, I should say. In this case, it's triangles. And the opposing antibodies that the recipient has, this is not a good thing. Someone must have made a mistake, right? When you have agglutination where these attack that, and you're trying to avoid that, this is the cross reaction. This is a picture of agglutination. When you break up the cells, all the hemoglobin that's released can get clogged up into the kidneys and you know, kidney failure. So we're trying to avoid this.
Professor,
yeah.
So if it fits, that means it's bad?
If it fits, it's bad.
Okay.
Yeah. Normally if it fits, it's good because your body's able to fight something off, right? Mm-hmm. Like when they give you your flu vaccine this year, what is it? It's a bunch of antigens of all the flu bugs CDC think you should be immune against. So they give you that, and then your body generates antibodies. You know the word antigen, why they use that term? Antigen is a short word for saying antibody generator. So in a vaccine, you're getting antigens without getting sick, but you're forcing your immune system to make antibodies against the foreign invaders. So if you get the actual flu bug, and you got the antibodies against it, and it fits, you're gonna fight that infection. Yeah, but see, you have to change your brain here because we don't want that to happen here. We want to have a successful transfusion. So, we don't want your immune system to work the way it's designed to. You wanna get someone else's blood without having this. So if you have a match, no bueno. So, donating blood is okay if donors' RBCs don't have antigens that will react to the recipient's antibodies. Okay? That's kind of why I did that exercise here. That's this. You're going to give this donated blood to this person, and this person does not have anything that will cross-react with what they're receiving. That's all I'm trying to say. So here, before you do this, and you're considering whether or not you can give this person this blood, consider the donor's antigens and the RBCs. Basically, that's what you're donating. The oxygen carrying capacity of that person's blood. Of course, they have antibodies in their plasma. I'm sure it's saved, but for our purposes, just consider that. And if you're the recipient, of course, you have RBCs, and we don't care about that. We care about the person receiving the blood, their immune system. Are they going to attack the blood that they're getting? So let's kind of start to go through the different types. Now you have figures in your book like this one, which show the different blood types. Let me just kind of go through all the types myself here. There's the ABO system. So let me tell you what's meant by that. ABO. If a person has type A blood, what that means is on their RBCs, they have the A antigen. The A antigen is present. That's what that means. Therefore, if the person is type B, same thing, right? What do they have present? B antigens. Okay. Now these type, these are two types. The O is, I guess, a type, but what it means is, think of O as like a zero. You don't have A or B. That's what type O is. A and B antigens are absent. So O is not an antigen. It means A and B are not there. And that's a common mistake I see on the exam. You start talking about O antigen. Like what? Mm-hmm. O is not antigen. Okay, well, just remember that definition. Yeah, physiology is very finicky. You make a mistake like that, and it's hard to give you any credit. So these definitions are very important. Now, there's another system based on an antigen we found in rhesus monkeys. It's called the Rh antigen. Sometimes books may call it the D antigen, if you ever see that. I tend to use Rh a little more, but I might use D. They're interchangeable. Just know both. So, now, for the Rh, they don't use Rh. They use plus minus. Okay. So if you see like a blood type and it has a little plus on it, well, you know, you've been around enough science classes. What does plus usually mean if we're talking about antigen? Do you think it's there or not?
Yes.
It's there. If you see a little plus, it means Rh antigen present. So therefore, if you see a little negative sign, what do you think that means? Rh antigen absent, it's not there. Okay. So these are the antigens that seem to cause problems when the medical community tries to transfuse people. So these are what you have to type for. There's other antigens, I'm sure, but these are the ones that we type for, and if you got these straight, there's usually not a problem. Okay, these three. So what are the three antigens? There's the A, there's the B, and the Rh. So those are the three antigens. And they're there or not. And you can be a type O. So let's kind of go through all the blood types. Let's go through all of them. Leave no stone unturned. But let's talk about what would be present on the RBCs and what antibodies that person would have, okay, in any given person. So I'll use this kind of symbology for our three antigens. Circles, the triangles, and the squares. So let's say you're a type A negative. I'm going to draw a little RBC here. Of our three antigens, there's one that's present. Which one is it? A. And that's it. Because what does the negative sign mean? Rh is absent. So I'll draw little circles there, all that. So this person would have the A antigen on their RBCs. Now you also have to, you don't know if you're going to be the donor or the recipient, right? If this person was the donor, for our purposes, well, we're concerned with the antigens that are present on the RBCs. What if they're the recipient? What are you concerned with? They're ABs. They're antibodies, right? So what you'd assume if you're a clinician is, if they have this antigen, it's safe to assume they don't have the antibody against it, or you could not live, right? We call that autoimmune reaction. You'd be attacking yourself. Assume they don't have the A antibody, you should assume they have the other two. Assume they got them. They probably do. So they probably have the antibody against B and Rh. Antibody against B. Antibody against Rh. Anti-B, anti-RH, however you want to put it, but that's what you should assume for a person who's type A negative. So any questions on what I did there? Know what antigens are present, and know what antibodies are present in a given type. Let's do one more. Here's, let's do type A positive. Which antigens are present?
A and
Rh. A and Rh. So I'll draw, how about we go Rh in this way? We'll go A, B, Rh. So we'll do that. So I'll draw circles, I'll draw squares. Therefore, what should you assume about the antibodies present? There should be one that you should assume.
B.
The antibody against B, because that's the only antigen they don't have. So all like, this one. So if you're A positive, that's kind of the game plan there. Let's do. If you're B negative. So then you're going to have that antigen. And you'll probably have antibodies against A and Rh. If you're B positive, you'll have surface antigens for B, and you'll have the antigen Rh, and you would have the antibody against A. If you're type O, just go over here. Thank you. O negative. Which antigens are present?
No.
None. None of them. So I'll just kind of leave it like that. Which antibodies are present? Probably all against all three. The one against A, the one against B, the one against Rh. So that's a special type. Now that type is called the universal donor. Well, I mean, that makes it so, I think by that name you can tell they make a good donor. Why? Donate to anybody. Why? What do you usually donate?
Antigens.
There's no antigens there. And why is that good? No matter who receives it, no cross reaction. So, you know, would they make a good recipient?
No.
Well, I guess you could receive from other O negatives, but if it was any other type, there'd probably be a problem. Okay. Let's do O positive. So for O positive, you have the Rh antigen present. And you have antibodies against A and B. There's the rare blood type AB. It could be AB positive or negative. If you're AB negative on your RBCs, you would have present the A antigen and the B antigen. No Rh, and you'd have the antibody against Rh. Okay. Last blood type. AB positive. Got all three, correct? You got the A antigen, the little circles. B, the triangles, and the squares. Okay, so I'm just drawing them all. Not all. Would you have antibodies against any of those?
No.
No, you wouldn't. So, no antibodies. Against A, B, or Rh. A lot of students, when they write about this, they say this person has no antibodies, and they stop right there. Why is that incorrect? Well, they have antibodies. They have an immune system. Just not against these three. There's millions. just against these, which is important for the transfusion thing. Okay. They call this type the universal recipient. Now, what makes this person a good recipient? Is it top thing or the bottom thing? The bottom thing, right? You get anyone's blood, doesn't matter whose it is, what type it is, there's none of these that will cross the eye. Okay. It's a very rare blood type. I had a student who was AB positive, and she was like, well, she was donating blood. They were very excited to receive her blood. And I was thinking, why? You don't want to give that to anybody. But this is good. Her plasma is probably good for other people. Okay. But again, for our test, when you donate blood, we're talking about this one. But I mean, it's not like when you donate blood, they throw away half of it. They fractionate it, and they save it all. It's very precious. So any questions on the different types that I went through? Know what's on their RBCs in terms of antigens, and know what's kind of in their plasma in terms of antibodies. Well, let me take you through a scenario like what I typically ask for tests. I just ask, can this person donate to that person? Kind of a scenario. And you just go through the logic. And I've made some multiple choice questions here. And to take you through that logic, this is how you should think when you solve these kinds of problems. And there's different ways you can solve these problems. You'll probably think of your own, as the students tend to do. You just go to class, and you like it, you don't like it, you figure out your own way. But I think for everybody, you should do it this way. If you try any other way, you tend to get all mixed up. Okay? Because the base, most basic way to think about it is what I'm presenting to you right now. Here, let's have a situation. John donate to Peter, and I have to give you the types, of course. John is he's AB negative. We're asking if he could be a donor to someone who's A positive. So that's the scenario. The first thing to recognize, who's the donor, who's the recipient? That's the first thing to get down, the types of who's getting what. We must first consider which of these choices, based on what we're talking about, is the correct answer. Well, if you're donating blood, what do you donate?
Antigens.
The RBCs, which got the antigens. So, okay, we consider John's antigens. And Peter, who's getting the blood, what are we concerned with? His antibodies. So the answer is B. That's the first thing you should consider. But let's go through and type out this thing, just like we just did. If John is AB, negative, which antigens are present? There's two of them.
A
and B. Very good, very good. So you got the little circles, and then you have the triangles. You know, I do ask about this on the written portion of the exam, this kind of thing. And I know I erased my legend. But sometimes students just do the circles, the squares, and the triangles, and they never designate what they're supposed to be. And you're not going to get credit for that. Because okay? That's just kind of my thing. I mean, they're not really circles and squares, right? You realize that. So you have to just make a legend, and you'll be okay. And this is not an antibody, right? It's an antigen, that's an antigen, that's the B, that's the A. What kind of antibodies would he have? The one against RH, although we're not concerned with that, but you know, let's just kind of put it there anyway, since we want to be thorough, we're just learning here. And if you this is the recipient, he has two antigens present. Which ones?
A
and RH. A and RH. So which antibodies are we concerned with that he has? The one against
B.
Okay, so we've got that all laid out. Let's go to my next question here. I think I already answered it. So, to kind of finish answering this question, can John donate to Peter? For John's blood type, he will have, and I kind of have it there, I think it's B, right? He has A and B antigens on his RBCs. Where we drew that out. For Peter's blood type, the thing we were concerned with are his antibodies. Which one does he have? It's the one against B. Only B antibodies, again, in his plasma. Okay, so that's what we're concerned with there. So for John, circle that. And then Peter's circle that. Well, now we can finally answer the question. I made it multiple choice. Well, the answer is no, right? But you have to put the correct reasoning, because what I always look for is, can the student identify what cross-reacts? Okay. And you have to be very specific about it, because I've defined three specific types, right? There's antigen against, there's antigen A, antigen B, antigen Rh, and there's antibodies against all of those three. Okay. So here's what cross-reacts. Right? Antibody B attacks antigen B. No. Peter's antibody B attacks John's antigen B. So what I wrote on the board is the phraseology that I think is specific enough. Some things I see on exams when you guys write about it, you just kind of vague. You just say, well, no, because they have different types. Or you say things like, well, that's correct, isn't it? But it's not going all, it's not that extra mile that I'm looking for. No, because they cross-react. You have to identify what cross-reacts, right? So it's like, which antibody attacks which antigen, and then you're okay. Let's go through a couple. Why don't you just try to work out this first one, Betty doing it to George. I'll give you a few minutes. See if you can do it just like I did. And I should be fair, you want to get this down before you leave today. When you have your blood typing lab on Monday, I'm going to give everyone an oral quiz. Okay? And this is the only oral quiz I give in this class. So usually how that works is, we're going to do the lab, it's a wet lab, and you're going to have four unknowns to type. You're going to type them, and if your group gets them all right, then you qualify for the next round, which is the oral quiz. And how I work it is, I give every student one question to answer, and you can come up as a group, so you're not, you know, by yourself in front of me. It's a little nerve-wracking that way. You can just have your lab mates around you for moral support. And you just have to answer the one question. I'll even give you the question in advance so you can think about it, so you can articulate your answer. And it's very important that you be able to think and articulate it correctly for that oral quiz. It really sets you up well for the written part of the test, which is for the next test. I ask about blood typing a lot. So start to get used to that thinking by doing this first one. Betty to George, go ahead. All right, you have plenty of time. First of all, for this one, is it yes or no?
No.
You cannot safely do this. Okay, now let's go through the reasoning. If you just, well, okay, at the very surface, A's can't donate to B's. Okay, with no training, you should be able to know that. Grab a person off the street. If you're type A, can you donate to someone who's type B? They'll be, oh, probably not, there's different types. But again, for us, for our class, we're gonna go tell them to cross react. So I'll just kind of do it again. I'll just do the whole thing for Betty, who is A negative. She's gonna have the A antigen. Nothing else. I'll go ahead and list her antibodies, even though we're not concerned with that. She's the donor. So she would have the antibodies against B and RA, even though for our scenario, we're just concerned with that. And then for George, who is type B positive, he's going to have the triangles that represents B, and the squares, which represent what? RH, very good. And the antibodies he would have are the ones against, well, the one he doesn't have, A. Boop. And for George, being the recipient, what are we concerned with? The ABs. Okay. And do you see a problem? Yes, this is the problem, so this is no, you can't do it. You cannot safely donate. No. George's A antibody would attack Betty's A antigen. Okay, that's kind of the phrasing. It's common for students to mix up antibody antigen terms. I do it myself when I think about this stuff. On tests, it's a real barn burner. When you start mixing up antibody antigen, because if you do it even one time, and I'm trying to grade your work, it's a huge headache, because I don't know what you know. You talk about it correctly here, but you switch it one time somewhere else, it's like I almost can't grade it. So those are two terms, really try hard not to mix them up. Makes your test really difficult to grade. It's already confusing. So that'll just kind of confound me a little bit more. I think I'll leave Mary and Joan. Maybe you can do that during the break, and you can quiz each other with that one. Together as a class, let's answer this one together. I ask this question a lot, like for the oral quiz, so you might get this question, you know. I'll say, oh, this person is a special blood type. Oh, yeah, they're the universal recipient. Why? How would you answer the question, why? Why is that the universal recipient? What would you put it?
No antibodies against A.
Yeah, no antibodies against the three. The A, the B, the RH. A common mistake I see with that question is students will say, oh, yeah, AB positive, they have all the antigens, and that's their answer. And why is that answer incorrect? That's not what makes them a good recipient. What makes you a good recipient is the absence of those three antibodies. So no matter what you get, nothing cross-reacts. Okay. So it's like you said something correct, but it wasn't what I was looking for, kind of a thing. And it's the same thing with this one. What makes a universal donor a universal donor? Are you going to tell me how they have no antibodies? Well, that's not what we're donating usually. What makes them a good donor is their CRIT, their RBCs, don't have any antigens. They don't have the A, the B, or the RH. That makes them good donors. So those are things to keep in mind. So any questions on universal whatever? Maybe you have to think about that. Okay. Let's look at this table, right? This table, I'm sure you can find a million versions of this table online. ABO and RH blood type donation showing matches between donor and recipient. So on the top, donors. On the side, recipients. Checkmark means it's okay. For example, what you should be able to know without thinking, same blood types can donate to each other, right? If you're O positive, you can give someone else who's O positive. Okay? If you're O negative, you know, you can donate to someone who's O negative, right? So same. So let's go through general rules that you should see from this table. Same types, same blood types. And donate to each other. That's an obvious one. So let me give you one that students usually have to kind of think about extensively. Here's one. Okay, positives. Donate to negatives.
No.
I heard a no. Let's give other people just time to mull that over. And positives donate to negatives. Any other yeses? Do I have any yeses? Always get one on the test. Well, the answer is no. Let's do the scenario of an O positive donating to an O negative. Because that is what we're talking about here. Because the positive negative thing refers to which antigen?
Rh.
Correct. All right, so if you're the type O positive, on your RBC, what is present?
Rh
antigen is present. Another common mistake is don't call the Rh antigen a plus antigen, right? Plus is the symbol we use, but don't call it a plus antigen. It's an Rh antigen. All right, so that's the donor. Let's talk about the recipient. So the donor's O positive, and he would have antibodies against, well, the other two, A and B. The recipient is O negative. They have no antigens. They have all the antibodies. The one against A, B, and Rh. So why is the answer no? Because what will cross-react?
Rh.
The Rh antibody will attack the Rh antigen when a positive donates to a negative, every time. And the negative has the antibody against the positive Rh antigen, the positive one. So let me reverse the question. Can negatives donate to positives? Is that a yes or a no? You're negative for the antibody, so you can just reverse that. There's a negative. Can he donate to someone who's positive? Well, if you're donating, what are you donating? The RBC? Doesn't have anything. Doesn't have the Rh antigen. Doesn't have anything else, for that matter. The recipient, who's O positive, well, they would have the antigen, antigen against, antigen for Rh, and for the antibodies, they would have antibody against A, antibody against B. So is that safe? Consider what's being donated and what the recipient has in their plasma. That is safe, right? There's no antibody to attack here. So the answer is yes. In every case, if you're negative, you can donate to someone who's positive. You can see that here. If you're negative, see all these positives? See how they're all blank? That means no bueno, correct? But if you're positive, well, you can donate to people who are positive or negative. Okay, I'm sorry. I said that wrong. If you're positive, you can only donate to someone else who is positive. Okay, that's all I was trying to say. You cannot donate to someone who's negative. I don't want to mess it up. All right, so the other thing is our universal stuff. Do you see this line here? You're the recipient. You're AB positive, you're the recipient. Every box is checked. What does that mean? You can receive blood, all of those types. You're the universal recipient. Now look at the O negative. See how all these boxes are checked? What is that blood type called again? Universal donor. You can donate to all of these types. Okay. So those are basically the general rules you can get from this table. It's a good thing to kind of check if you're kind of testing yourself. To get you ready for Monday's lab, this is it. Understanding this kind of analysis, this is what you're going to do. You're going to take an unknown blood type and you're going to type it. So let me explain how that's done in the lab. And the blood we're using is fake blood, so it's not real blood. We certainly don't want to prick you guys and make you bleed. We don't do that anymore. So it's all fake stuff, but it's a good exercise and it shows you how it would really work. Unknown. You want to type it. Okay? Maybe that person's blood can be donated to someone in the hospital. What you can do is you can take that unknown blood. In your lab, you have anti-sera with antibodies against A, B, or Rh in your lab. Okay. When you type someone's blood, you're testing for the presence or absence of antigens when you type someone's blood. Unknown? When you type someone's blood, you're type for, well, I should say test for, it's a better word. Test for the presence or absence of antigens. That's what the test is. Because if you know which antigens are present or absent, then you can type it, right? That's how we name it, name the types. And so what you need to do that is have in your lab prepared anti-A, anti-B, anti-Rh. So when it says serum, it's basically the plasma without the clotting factors. You know there's a bunch of antibody against A in there. So what you do is, in your well, you know, put the blood in it, okay? And then add unknown blood. But then also add antibody against A in the well, and then mix it up. See what happens, okay? If nothing happens, the blood just stays, there's no agglutination, nothing happens. I'll just kind of draw, I don't know how to draw that. It's just, let me just kind of draw like that and just put it. You can put negative, nothing happens. No agglutination. You added the unknown blood, all whatever's there, I mean, then you put the antibody with it and nothing happened. What conclusion do you make in terms of answering this question? What could you say? Something's absent. What? You're testing for the presence of absence of antigens. You added an antibody to it. So certainly there's an antibody there, the one you added. But we don't care about that. What's the unknown? What can you say? I haven't heard it yet. You could say, I hope some of you are thinking this, antigen A is absent. Right? That's what you could say for this result. One, you get a positive result. Okay, so you added the antibody against B, and you got this clumping, this agglutination is all clumped up. Positive. That's the result. How do you interpret the result? What do you say? Antigen B is there. That's all you can say. I mean, you didn't know it was there, but if you add antibody B and it agglutinates, it clumped it up, it bound it. That's the correct result, or correct interpretation of the result. So right now, without even doing the third one, you could say they're type B, right? They got antigen B, you've confirmed it. Add the old RH to get a positive result or a negative result. I'm doing number one, by the way. Is that a positive or negative result according to this picture?
Negative.
That's negative. No agglutination, nothing happened. Means Rh antigen not there, it's absent. What blood type are they?
Or B.
They're definitely B, positive or negative. What blood type is this? B, positive or negative?
Negative.
So that'll be the correct answer there. That's their type. Okay. That's how you do that analysis. Let's see if you understand this by doing 2, 3, or 4 together without doing the whole mapping it out on the board thing. You should be able to do a quick thing here. For those of you who get this, and I know some of you are at different levels with this, what's number two? What's their type?
O positive.
O positive. Is that clicking for some of you?
O positive.
Good job,
Officer.
Okay.
Good job.
Okay, what about number three?
B positive.
B positive. And four? O negative is correct. So for those of you who are just kind of like, okay, I'm starting to see here. I ask, you know, I get your result tomorrow, or not tomorrow, but Monday, and they're like, huh, you put a negative sign here. What does that mean? What does it mean you put negative? What does that mean? You're like, what? It means it's negative. I'm like, what does that mean? How do you interpret the result? It's negative? What am I looking for? Tell me what is present or absent. You know, tell me what's absent if it's negative. If it's, I'll say, you put a positive there. What does that mean? Don't tell me it means it's positive. I'm asking you to interpret the result. Saying it's positive is not interpreting the result, right? It means it's, oh, the B antigen is there. That's what that means. So that's the answer to that question. I have a clinical example here for you about all this. But any questions on that? That's kind of how we type unknown blood. Here's a case of hemolytic diseases of newborns. Urethroblastosis fetalis. Has to do with the Rh antigen. So let's say you have a pregnancy and your mom is Rh negative. Zoom in on this chart here. This is like the placenta. Mom's Rh negative, but dad is Rh positive. Therefore, fetus is Rh positive. Okay? And it's okay, there's nothing crossing here. But at delivery, there's a lot of bleeding. It's possible that some of the baby's blood, just a little bit, can get into mom's blood. Now, mom's not in trouble. It's not a large enough amount to cause problems for mom. But what mom would do is she would develop antibodies against what? Rh. She would. And baby's going to be okay because baby's being delivered. Baby's gone. Okay. Now, the problem could arise because now, for the second pregnancy, now mom has been sensitized to Rh quite a bit. She probably has a lot of Rh antibody circulating. So I mean, if no measures are taken, the second pregnancy, it could cause a problem. The antibody against Rh can cross the placenta and attack baby's RBCs, a condition called urethroblastosis. Okay. Now usually, I mean, this is prevented. You're pregnant and they ask you, are you Rh negative? And if dad's Rh positive, then they'll just, for the first pregnancy, they'll just kind of zap it out, give you Rogaine or something. But in terms of what we're talking about, you should understand this, right? How antibodies attack antigens. All right. I have on these slides a PhysioX blood analysis. I'm not going to assign it. I'm trying to get away from PhysioX. So you can just ignore that, okay? And so just take it off your plate. Let's take a break. When we come back, I'm going to talk about white blood cells and blood coagulation.